want to welcome you this morning on this beautiful, frosty Sunday morning as we continue to celebrate Lent, as we continue to look at what it means to be on this journey towards Jerusalem with Jesus. I want to welcome you on behalf of the members of this church. If you happen to be a guest, we will hope that you feel welcome and that you'd let us know who you are by putting your name in the guest book. I would encourage all of the rest of you that are members here or continuing regular attenders to also please put your name in the guest book so that we know that you are here this Sunday, just in case I didn't happen to see you or recognize your smiling face in the midst this morning. It's really hard for us pastors. We kind of have this memory block on Sunday morning. It's like we get to noon and it's like a blur of whatever happened that morning and try to remember those details. But I would encourage you to add that to your routine this morning, to write that in there, and then pass it back down so that you can take a look at who's in the pew with you. Because there might be somebody that you don't quite remember what their name is, and when we get to the greeting, you can welcome them and greet them wholeheartedly and with a hearty handshake and a clap on the back or whatever that would be. So at this time, let us stand and raise our voices together as we sing and bring in the light of Christ. Oh, Lord, this morning, we just ask that you pour out your Spirit upon us, that we may feel your grace, experience your love, and be one with your presence here in this, your sanctuary. Lord, you've heard the concerns this morning, to be with Dwayne's family, to be with John and his family, to be with Tom and Connie as they seek healing and renewal. Lord, we ask that you continue to pour out your blessings upon them, upon those who are caring for them, upon those who love them, to give them strength and courage and the ability to seek your face, embrace your love. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for birthdays. We thank you for those who have gathered around us to celebrate. But Lord, most of all, I thank you for bringing these, your people, to this place to celebrate your love, to know your peace, to practice your mercy and justice. So Lord, this morning, we, your people, ask that you continue to reach out to the least and the lost, using us as your hands and your feet. Lord, we ask that you protect those who are being persecuted in churches around the world this morning. Lord, we ask that you be with those who are standing in harm's way, those who are seeking to bring about peace and justice, that you may give them the temperament and the wisdom to do like you do, to love, to protect. Lord, protect them if it comes down to they have to sacrifice. Lord, we ask that you wrap your arms around those this morning that are dealing with issues of addiction and abuse. Those within our own congregation and our own communities, as well as those around the world. Lord, they're lost, seeking your help. Lord, I also ask that you may pour out your Spirit upon us to engage us, to stoke that small flame within us so that it may burn bright, so that those who see us may recognize you in our acts, in our face, in our actions. But Lord, in order to do that, we need to come to you. So Lord, hear now in our silence our pleas for forgiveness, our petitions for those things that we cannot speak aloud. And Lord, allow us to hear your voice, to feel your calling, and to do your will. So Lord, be with us now. Thank you for walking with us day by day as we walk towards Easter, and as we prepare ourselves to remember and to rejoice. We ask that you continue to push us, to hold us, to lead us and guide us to places that you need our voice, you need our hands. So Lord, we thank you and praise you with that prayer that you taught your disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Liturgy comes from Luke 14. Healing on the Sabbath. One Sabbath, when Jesus went to share a meal in the home of one of the leaders of the Pharisees, they were watching him closely. A man suffering an abnormal swelling of the body was there. Jesus asked the lawyers and the Pharisees, "Does the law allow healing on the Sabbath or not?" They said nothing. Jesus took hold of the sick man, cured him, and then let him go. He said to them, "Suppose your child or ox fell into the ditch on the Sabbath day. Wouldn't you immediately pull it out?" But they had no response.
Amen. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thank you. As we continue our journey towards Jerusalem, as we continue down this trail of tears, this way of sorrow that Christ has taken upon himself to head from the lush green lands around Galilee, to head to the barrenness of the Dead Sea and Jericho and the hills of Jerusalem. We find him on this fifth week, the beginning of this fifth week of Lent, midway there, stopping at the house of an unknown Pharisee to have a meal on the Sabbath. So it's a Saturday afternoon, and Jesus has been working his way from town to town. We've heard about the fact that has all been prepared for him. Jesus sent out his disciples ahead of him to find places for Jesus to come and to preach, places to stay, places to eat, and laid out that itinerary to make his way day by day closer and closer to Jerusalem. Our first scripture reading this morning tells us about the fact that he gets there and they're having a meal. And you need to know that the tension would have had to have been very, very high, because Jesus had already been butting heads with the Pharisees for the past 3 years. Jesus had been in their face with his teachings. He had been in their face with his practices. He had kind of put his nose up to them and basically told them that they really didn't know what they were talking about. He'd performed miracles and done other things when he shouldn't have. He made pronunciations that they didn't like. And here on this Sunday, as they sat around having the meal, a man came in with some kind of ailment where his body was swollen beyond normal. And Jesus healed him. The scriptures tell us that he immediately sent him away, probably to ease the tension, because you can almost imagine that these Pharisees, who don't believe you should do anything on the Sabbath, in fact, so much so that the entire meal would be prepared on Friday. It would all be laid out. The tables would be set. Nothing got done on the Sabbath except pull the food out and eat it. I don't know how they warmed it. Never quite gone into that explanation, but they would not light a candle. They would not move or set anything. And yet Jesus heals the man in their presence at the table in defiance of all that the Pharisees held dear. And then Jesus sends him away, but with a word to everyone at the table. Well, if your child fell in a ditch or your cow fell in a ditch, wouldn't you rescue them on a Sabbath? And of course, we know the answer. Of course they would. For one, they love their children, and they cherish the wealth that the cow brings them. They would not allow that to sit for 24 hours till the next day. So Jesus was trying to let them know that God does not take a day off. God does not say that this may be my day of rest, but that doesn't mean I will not save. Jesus then continues after that. He and his disciples leave. And we hear these words continuing on in Luke 14, starting at verse 25. It says, large crowds were traveling with Jesus. Turning to them, he said, whoever comes to me and doesn't hate father and mother, spouse and children, and brothers and sisters, yes, even one's own life, cannot be my disciple. Whoever doesn't carry their own cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. He then finishes that section with the words that I was telling the kids about. Salt is good, but if salt loses its flavor, how will it become salty again? It has no value, neither for the soil nor for the manure pile. People throw it away. Whoever has ears to hear should pay attention. These were Jesus' words as he traveled on to Jerusalem after confronting that Pharisee. And they seem like extremely harsh words to us, for Jesus to tell us that unless you hate your mother, unless you hate your father, unless you hate your children, your brothers and your sisters, and even if you need to even hate your own life if you want to be my disciple. Seems horribly harsh to those of us here in the 21st century. But you see, Jesus was turning to this large crowd behind him who were following him. And Jesus was not about large crowds. Jesus was not into keeping track of attendance and making sure that it went up every week. He wasn't worried about whether or not people were hearing him. He was trying to make disciples. And there's a difference between a disciple and a follower. A follower is somebody who can root them on, somebody who can actually really enjoy listening to the words and embrace those words and actually be a part of the history that they make. Most of us can be followers of a sports team. We love to watch the Cubs or the Vikings or the Bears, or you name one. I'm not going to start picking ones because I'll get in trouble. But we can be followers. We can even be fans. We can be fanatical about it. And, you know, paint it up, put a cheese thing on our head, or do whatever it is that people do for whatever sport they want. We can do that kind of stuff. But that doesn't make you a disciple of the Packers. Now, I know there's some cheeseheads probably in this group. And if there's anybody that comes close to being disciples, it's Packer fans. But see, they're raising their hands already. That's right. But to be a true disciple literally would mean, and some of you might like to do this, you would move to Green Bay and live in Lambeau Stadium. You would eat nothing but concession stand food. You would have the book, all the books about Lombardi. You would have his notes, everything. And that is what you would pray to, and that's what you would believe in, and that's what everything would be about. You would make holy tributes and pilgrimages to see the trophies. You would be doing all that kind of stuff. That would be a true disciple of a team. And that is not what we are. We may be fanatical fans. We may be deep followers. But Jesus is looking for disciples. Somebody who is willing to live the life that Jesus lived. To love like Jesus loved. To sacrifice like Jesus sacrificed. He basically wants all these people behind him to hear that that is what he has had to do. He had to turn his back on his mother and on his father, on his brothers and sisters, who I'm sure that he loved, but he had to walk away. And during these last weeks, as he's walking to Jerusalem, he had to do it even more so. We've been watching some movies on Sunday nights as part of the preparation for Lent. And the last one last week actually kind of touched on it, because they had a scene written by a screenwriter who basically had Mary pleading with Jesus not to go to Jerusalem. You don't want to do that. I need you near me. That type of thing. But he had to go anyway. He had to be a part of that. He could not listen to the wisdom and concerns of his mother and of his father, of his brothers and of his sisters. He had to do what God had sent him on the road to do. Now, I know some of you are thinking, oh my goodness, if that's what Jesus is requiring of me, I don't think I can do it. Well, you know, join the rest of us in this room. Because Jesus does not expect perfection from us. He knows already that we're fans. He knows already that we're followers. He knows that there's part of us that really wants to be a full-blood disciple. Now, I want to confess to you, as a person who has been called to the ministry, who has done and sacrificed and done things in the name of Christ that probably most of you would not have done, I'm still not there yet. I'm not there by a long ways. I'm not ready to never talk to my mother and father and my brothers and sisters again. I'm not ready, like he told the young rich ruler, to sell all I have and follow Jesus. I'm not ready to say goodbye to my daughter and my precious grandchildren and head off into whatever area that God's calling me. But I know that Jesus loves me still and continues to work and do the best that he can through me to the places that I can go, in the life that I lead with my children, my grandchildren, my parents, with you, my brothers and sisters in Christ. And that is what Christ is calling us to do today. Christ knows what it is that you have, that you can give to build this kingdom. Christ knows what it is that you bring to offer to this community that can bring about what I've been calling this experimental patch of heaven right here on this plot. So that when people drive by, they'll go, there's something special going on in that church. And I want to know the Savior that led those people here. Because that scripture in between what I read, Jesus gives us a hint. He says, if you wanted to build a tower, wouldn't you first sit down and calculate the cost to determine whether you have enough money to complete it? Otherwise, when you have laid the foundation but couldn't finish the tower, all who see it will begin to belittle you. They will say, here's the person who began construction and didn't complete it. Well, I'm telling you that God has already made those calculations. God has already prepared the plans to build God's tower, God's kingdom here on earth. And he knows what each and every one of you can contribute. Spiritually, physically, emotionally. God has prepared that plan and has prepared your life to be an integral part of doing what is necessary here in the United Methodist Church of Wilton to bring in our brothers and sisters from Walcott and Durant, from Tipton to Muscatine to Moscow to all of those places. God has preparing our hearts, our minds, and our souls to reach out to our neighbors. And that is the salt that God has placed within you so that you can go out. And like I told the little ones, be the seasoning that makes people want to be like you so that they can meet your Savior and they can do what it is that you have done, experience what you have experienced.